The year is 1973. The world is in a complicated place. The United States have just pulled out of the Vietnam War after months of civil unrest due to their involvement. On top of that, the Watergate scandal was developing, which would lead to an impeachment trial of Richard Nixon. Things were complicated, and the films of the day reflected that. But in August of 1973, an up-and-coming filmmaker named George Lucas released American Graffiti, a film about his own life experiences during the 1960s. And despite it only capturing the time period from 10 years prior, the film had a simplicity to it that was refreshing for the time. It was nostalgic. American Graffiti became widely successful, becoming the third biggest film of the year. In a New York Times interview for the film, however, George Lucas reveals he's working on a science fiction film akin to Flash Gordon serials of the past. The film is known as Star Wars. The general public didn't really know these two words just yet, and it wasn't for a while that eyes turned towards the film with curiosity. For that, we'll have to journey through the last 40 years and look at the cultural significance of Star Wars, and how it evolved over the decades to become one of the most successful and popular film franchises of all time. This is Star Wars, a complete retrospective. 3 years later, not much is known about this Star Wars project. It was tossed around from studio to studio until finally landing in the hands of 20th Century Fox. Towards the end of the year, audiences would get their first look at the film with a brand new trailer in the fall.
20th Century Fox and George Lucas, the man who brought you American Graffiti, now bring you an adventure unlike anything on your planet.
This was enough to get people interested. It already showed some hints of the groundbreaking work done at Industrial Light and Magic. But while certain details were now known, including the looks at a far more simple story about good and evil, there was still a lot unknown about Star Wars. And people needed to wait until May 25th, 1977, to see the final film. And so the day arrived, and people began to line up in droves to see the new film. Initial turnouts weren't massive, but once people saw the movie, word of mouth snowballed the popularity. Images are seen of people lined up and down the streets to see the new Star Wars movie. But what happens when you see the movie? What is the movie? Well, in the first few seconds, audiences were treated with this. The instant blaring music immediately got audiences into the movie. On top of the fact that the movie just started, there were no opening credits, unlike every other movie of the day. There was simply a crawl detailing where we were in the universe and a pan down to an alien planet. The situation was immediately clear with a small rebel cruiser being dwarfed by an Imperial Star Destroyer. Audiences were suddenly whisked away to this fantastical other universe. The characters sucked them in. C-3PO, R2-D2, Princess Leia, Luke Skywalker, Han Solo, Chewbacca, Ben Kenobi, and of course their foe, the sinister Darth Vader.
I find your lack of faith disturbing.
The goal of the movie was clear. This band of unlikely heroes needed to get the stolen Death Star plans to the Rebellion so that they could destroy the Death Star itself and strike at the heart of the Empire. This simple story about good and evil inspired people everywhere. They wanted Luke Skywalker to succeed, and they cheered when he finally did. The celebration at the end left audiences satisfied with this journey to another world, a true escapist movie allowing people to forget the complicated world they lived in for a simple black and white adventure about good triumphing over evil. But the film's success wasn't due to the crowd seeing it for the first time. The film was a major success because people saw it again and again and again. Audiences could not get enough of Luke Skywalker, Han Solo, and Princess Leia, and who can blame them? The film is exciting, it's fast-paced, the visual effects are phenomenal, the goal is clear, and it's just a lot of fun.
You think a princess and a guy like me?
No.
It inspired people of all ages, and kids could imagine their own Star Wars adventures with a line of toys that flew off the shelves. In fact, it flew off the shelves so fast that the infamous empty box became a thing, a promise to toy buyers that they'd get the toys when the manufacturers were finally caught up with demand. Star Wars changed everything and caused an onslaught of similar movies, but none could recapture the awe felt by the original Star Wars. Maybe it was a one-time event. Perhaps nothing like Star Wars would come again. But that was not to be, because George Lucas and others began work on not one but two more Star Wars movies. First was to be released in 1980, 3 years after the original. In the meantime, however, audiences would rush back to the theater again and again to experience the destruction of the Death Star and all the other moments from the original movie. 2 years later, however, first news came about for the sequel. It is unknown when the title was announced, but in the fall of 1979, a trailer was released for the Star Wars sequel.
A big, new, sprawling space adventure in the Star Wars saga, The Empire Strikes Back.
Promising to follow up on the original in new and exciting ways, reuniting our existing characters and meeting new ones along the way. Fans were undoubtedly excited for the second adventure in the franchise, to revisit their favorite characters, and soon enough, the year arrived. A week before the release of Empire Strikes Back, the title for the third film was revealed, Star Wars: Revenge of the Jedi, set to release in 1983. Fans knew more was coming. But that didn't stop another onslaught of audiences returning to theaters for Empire Strikes Back. And the film opened similarly to the original, the iconic music opening the film, and a crawl. Star Wars Episode 5. Wait, 5? What? Did we miss a bunch of movies? I thought this was the second one. No movies were missed. In fact, it was here it was revealed that this trilogy, Star Wars, as well as The Empire Strikes Back and Revenge of the Jedi, was episodes 4, 5, and 6, and that eventually two more trilogies would be made. First up would be a trilogy going back in time, episodes 1, 2, and 3, followed thereafter by episodes 7, 8, and 9. The universe just got a whole lot bigger, and it was felt in Empire Strikes Back. With the introduction of new characters such as Yoda, who's awesome by the way, the moment he appears things really light up. He's having a lot of fun. His speech patterns are unique, no character ever sounded like Yoda. But also he had words of wisdom to impart on audiences and Luke alike.
This one, a long time have I watched. All his life as he looked away to the future, to the horizon, never his mind on where he was. What he was doing. Luminous beings are we, not this crude matter. You must feel the force around you. Do or do not. There is no try.
But the biggest feeling audiences got from Empire was that of a darker story. A smaller scale story than the original, focusing more on characters and their continuing plight against the Empire. The shock was felt when Han Solo was put into carbon freeze. But that was nothing compared to the earth-shattering reveal at the end of the film. Darth Vader reveals the fate of Luke Skywalker's father, and it reveals that it wasn't he who killed him, but it was Obi-Wan! Obi-Wan killed Luke's father! What? Oh, that's not how it went. Oh, that was the fake ending meant to keep people from knowing the real ending? So what was the real ending?
He told me you killed him.
No. I am your father.
What? Darth Vader is Luke's father? That's not true. That's impossible! But that was the revelation left with audiences at the end of the movie, and they were left with this bittersweet conclusion, the rebellion limping away as Lando and Chewbacca went off in pursuit of Han Solo. The mystery of who Darth Vader really was seemed like it was revealed, but things were still in the air. Was he lying? Is he actually Luke's father? On top of that, when will Han Solo be free of carbonite? Man, I gotta know the answers to these questions. I gotta see the third movie. When did you say the third movie was? 1983. Oh man, I gotta wait 3 years to see this wrap up? Fine. But I'm not gonna be happy about it. Immediate reactions to Empire weren't as favorable as the original, but over time this film was garnered as a classic. Not only is it now widely regarded as the best Star Wars movie, but also one of the best sequels of all time, and to some, one of the best movies of all time. The direction it took the universe while still being fun and exciting with fast-paced action, spectacular visual effects, while diving deeper into character, is why we still look at this movie as the pinnacle of sequels and a pinnacle of the series. But the story wasn't finished yet. One more chapter remained in this Star Wars trilogy. But before the third installment, the original film was re-released to theaters. But not exactly as it was in 1977. This time, a small change was made to the title crawl, now calling it Episode 4, A New Hope. This cemented the fact that this was the middle trilogy in an eventual 9-film saga, and audiences were eagerly awaiting every installment of the franchise, hoping that one day they'd see all 9 films. But they only had 2. There was another to go in this original trilogy. In the fall of 1982, audiences finally got their first glimpse of the third installment, Revenge of the Jedi. A full 90-second trailer revealed that we follow our favorite characters, including Han Solo, who would be freed from carbonite. Revenge of the Jedi was shaping up to be a hotly anticipated What? They changed that? That's odd. I mean, we're like 5 months out. Okay. Well, I just got word that the title of the third film has been changed to Return of the Jedi. And with it, the same trailer was re-released, this time with the new title. But this didn't stop excitement for Return of the Jedi, and early in the year 1983, a second trailer was released, promising that audiences would get confirmation on whether Darth Vader was really Luke's father, as well as a look at the dreaded Emperor, the Sith Lord who runs the Empire. And on May 25th, 1983, a full 6 years to the day after the original film was released, audiences turned out once again to see Return of the Jedi. And while the film was not as critically acclaimed as the original two movies, it still satisfied audience members everywhere. Han Solo was freed from carbonite, and his mysterious captor Jabba was revealed and shortly killed. The truth was revealed by a dying Yoda that Darth Vader truly was Luke's father. A sense of finality washed over the film as audiences watched the rebellion's final stand against the Empire and their new Death Star. But the most interesting aspect of this conclusion was Luke, Vader, and the Emperor. Their dynamic was amazing, how there's so much going on that's unsaid, how each character has their own goals. And it results in this haunting moment where Luke goes all out on Vader with this bone-chilling music playing over the top of it. But in the end, Luke Skywalker manages to turn Darth Vader back into the once respected Anakin Skywalker, who throws the Emperor over a ledge, and the Emperor explodes. Shortly after, completing his redemption, Darth Vader, now Anakin Skywalker, also dies a peaceful death before the rebellion destroys the second Death Star. The victory was felt everywhere. The tyrannical Empire was defeated. The rebellion had won. This felt like the ultimate conclusion, and as we saw the Ewoks and the rebellion celebrating to Yub-Nub, there was a sense of satisfaction. The war was over, and George Lucas himself said he'd step away from the franchise for the time being. But what was still hanging in the air was that this was the middle trilogy, and maybe one day the promised 9-film saga would come to fruition. But the original Star Wars trilogy would have to do, a trilogy that inspired so many, that got people united, celebrating the defeat of the Empire. And the film was a commercial success, but not quite as revered as the original two. But even Roger Ebert and Gene Siskel defended it against another fellow critic.
I think all movies are special effects. Movies are not real. They're two-dimensional. A film goes through the camera, the projector throws the light on the screen, and that makes a special effect. It's a dream. It's an imagination. As to whether this film is good or not, it excited me. It made me laugh. It made me thrilled. And that's what a movie like this is for. I also enjoy films by Ingmar Bergman and people like that. I share that taste with Mr. Simon. But I try, I think, in my own movie-going taste to be broad enough to also understand why a bunch of people might want to get together and see a Star Wars movie and enjoy it.
With a completed trilogy and a new generation of film lovers growing up over time, the question was still looming over people's heads. When will Star Wars return? Maybe it never would. It was a full 10 years of silence about the future of Star Wars. A new generation had grown up only knowing the trilogy as a VHS box set. And while audiences were satisfied with the trilogy, it still drove fans nuts that there were technically was no first movie. But George Lucas finally broke his silence in 1993, announcing that he would return to Star Wars to make episodes 1, 2, and 3. But that was it. There was no promise of a 7, 8, or 9. Just a trilogy set prior to the originals. Star Wars was coming back, and audiences were ready for it. But it still would be a bit of a wait, as the new trilogy was to start with Episode 1 in 1999, followed in 2002 and 2005 by Episodes 2 and 3. Fans were eager to learn anything about the new trilogy, and in the year 1997, audiences got a tease as to what they could expect from the new technology in the form of the Star Wars Special Editions.
The Star Wars Trilogy. Special edition. See it again for the first time.
The Force will be with you always.
The original trilogy was re-released to theaters in the first months of 1997, and audiences turned out yet again to see the original movies. This time there were new enhanced visual effects, subtle changes to the film with new surprises and new things across the trilogy. These changes were met with criticism? It certainly displayed a turning point in the relationship of fans to George Lucas, but despite that, it was the most successful re-release of all time. A new generation got to see the films on the big screen, and the generation that grew up with it before got the chance to see it all over again. But fans still wanted to see what the new trilogy was going to be, and a year later, a piece of information was revealed. In September 1998, the first official piece of information about the first in the new trilogy was announced. The title of Episode 1. The film was called Star Wars Episode 1, The Phantom Menace. And Star Wars fans everywhere collectively said, "What? Huh? That doesn't sound right." Early internet message boards displayed some concern over the title. It didn't sound right. While some believed that the movie would be fantastic and that all would be revealed in time, others were worried this might be a signal to the quality of the movie. But all fears were squashed when a trailer was released in November 1998 in front of the film Meet Joe Black, and audiences turned out in droves to see the trailer. They'd buy a ticket for Meet Joe Black, and before the movie, the Phantom Menace trailer would play, and when it was over, they'd leave. You can see footage of people excited over just the trailer, a solid 2 minutes of new Star Wars footage. And who can blame them? I mean, the trailer's amazing. Any worries over the title was swept under the rug. Star Wars was back in a big way, and audiences couldn't wait until May of 1999 to see the first brand new Star Wars movie in 16 years. In March 1999, another trailer was released in front of Wing Commander, which my dad likes that movie. I don't know if anyone else likes that movie. No one ever talks about it. Tell me if you like that movie in the comments or whatever. While a similar situation happened to Wing Commander, it wasn't quite at the same scale as the first trailer, but it still got audiences excited to see the first in the new trilogy of Star Wars movies. And on May 19th, 1999, audiences finally got their chance. People took the day off work to be in line to be one of the first to see Episode 1. It was an event like no other before. Excitement was off the charts. People were dressed up in new and old costumes. Interviews of the day showed the electric energy. And for those that got into the midnight screening, they were ecstatic. They were going to be a part of history.
This is a huge deal for me. I was sick from school today.
I want to be the guy coming out of the theater going, "It was great!" You know, that's who I want to be.
I've been waiting 15 years since Return of the Jedi came out to see the prequel.
There's no way it's going to be a disappointment.
There's no way it's going to suck.
Well, it could suck.
It could not suck.
How could it suck?
And so the movie finally started. The 20th Century Fox logo appeared and people cheered. Lucasfilm appeared and people cheered. The energy was unlike anything. It was an amazing moment, a part of everyone's favorite experience of the time. They were all there to see the brand new Star Wars movie. Episode 1, The Phantom Menace. Turmoil has engulfed the Galactic Republic, The taxation of trade routes to outlying star systems is in dispute. Huh? What? That doesn't sound right. The opening crawl, while it looked like Star Wars, didn't read like Star Wars. But people were still excited. The movie hadn't really started, after all. But the movie did start, with this slow docking sequence, and two mysterious figures being slowly led into a room. And early on, Obi-Wan says,
"I have a bad feeling about this."
A laugh and applause was probably expected at this moment, but all people could feel was, "Yeah, I do have a bad feeling about this." The feeling of excitement soon dropped down into this feeling of dread. Oh no. What if it's actually bad? The movie continued, but it wasn't landing. It wasn't working. It kept chugging along at a fast pace, but didn't feel right. Unlike the reactions to the originals, which were filled with cheers and applause and laughter, early screenings for The Phantom Menace were dead silent. When the film ended, people were more confused than excited for more. But still, people leaving the theater seemed really excited, and I genuinely think they enjoyed themselves. There isn't a hint of hesitation among these people. They loved it, and they wanted to see it again.
Fantastic. Go see it as quick as you can.
It was better than all of them.
I think the lightsaber battles were the greatest.
It was good, dude. It was really good.
So worth it. So worth it.
They're gonna love it. They're gonna go nuts. It was amazing.
I couldn't get enough of it. I want to see it again already.
It was amazing. It was everything I thought it was going to be and more.
But over time, I think it really set in that this movie did... It wasn't up to snuff. While the movie was around the same length as Return of the Jedi, it felt an hour longer. The characters were boring, there was no humor to be found, and the most cartoonish kid appeal character, Jar Jar, wasn't particularly funny to older audiences, despite the fact that he's the only one that has any shred of life to him.
He's a guy!
Come on, R2.
It's a good thing Ahmed Best is back in Star Wars, though. Good for him. The Senate hearings in the middle of the movie underlined the real problem, however. The movie was boring. Qui-Gon and Obi-Wan had no personal stake in what was going on. They were thrown from set piece to set piece, and each time they seemed like they were on top of things.
There are too many of them.
It won't be a problem.
Is he nervous?
He's fine.
The difficulty is getting into the throne room. Once we're inside, we shouldn't have a problem.
Every encounter was the same. There's a room full of droids, so let's bust out our lightsabers and slice them to pieces, no problem. The Phantom Menace was this massive shift in public perception of Star Wars. The extent to its anticipation and the extent of its disappointment was unmatched by anything that came before or since. But it was a disappointment. While initial reactions were favorable, audiences soon soured on the movie. It was a big misstep right out of the gate. And I almost feel bad for George Lucas. He had been working on these ideas for years, mapping out what happened before the original trilogy, and it was his first time back at the helm since the original, and this level of disappointment probably hit him like a ton of bricks. But that's not to say there was nothing redeemable about Episode 1. The pod race was exciting, mainly because it was the only time anyone was really in any danger. The final lightsaber battle, despite there not really being anything going on between the characters, was visually exciting, and the death of Qui-Gon wasn't terrible. Despite the fact that Qui-Gon sucks, dude. He is so terrible. Every single problem he comes across, he just does it like a mind trick, like, or he rigs games. This guy, he's just awful. But the film was visually impressive, and was a major breakthrough in visual effects, much like the original three movies. However, there were still two more Star Wars movies in this trilogy, Episodes 2 and 3, set to release in 2002 and 2005, respectively. But I think audiences were worried. It was proven that a Star Wars movie wasn't good, so maybe the following movies might follow the trend. But there was still a chance to pull together the trilogy. Perhaps Episode 2 would prove people wrong, that Episode 1 was just an anomaly, that the remaining two films would be seen as amazing. But one thing was certain. Perception of Star Wars was forever changed by The Phantom Menace, and audiences waited with bated breath for the next 3 years in anticipation of Episode 2. I think it's important to mention that despite the fact that The Phantom Menace was considered a disappointment, people were still excited for the future. There were, after all, new Star Wars movies coming out, and the idea of this trilogy happening at all was enough to get people energized. And in the lead-up to Episode 2, there are a lot of internet blogs and posts that are taking any little piece of information they can get about the next movie. They're speculating, having fun, getting excited about casting announcements, or any other scrap of information they can get. But the first big piece of news came in August of 2001, almost a year prior to the release of Episode 2. And this was the reveal of the title. Star Wars Episode 2. attack of the clones. The consensus of the time was largely mixed, with people citing it as being campy and in the vein of movies like Attack of the Killer Tomatoes or Attack of the 50-Foot Woman. For whatever reason, audiences still didn't really think it sounded like Star Wars. But overall, the reaction seemed less shocked than with The Phantom Menace. But there was this air of people bracing for another potential disappointment. But in November of 2001, not one, not two, but three teasers were released to promote Attack of the Clones. Depending on what movie you saw in the month of November, whether it be Monsters, Inc., or Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone, or if you downloaded the trailers online, you got a glimpse of the second part of the prequel trilogy. And overall, excitement ramped up. While the excitement didn't seem to be nearly at the level for Phantom Menace, it seemed that fans were hopeful for the second film. The teasers were filled with action, lightsabers, ships flying around. It looked exciting, and it would dive more into Anakin turning into Darth Vader. It was an exciting time. After all, there was a new Star Wars movie, and it looked better than the last one. And look at that, it's Jango Fett. He looks like Boba Fett, and I like Boba Fett. So it seems most hesitations were put to rest in order for fans to get excited for Attack of the Clones. In March of 2002, a second full trailer was released for Attack of the Clones, and this one really got people excited. It promised big action, big spectacle, none of that boring stuff from the last one. This was going to be purely Star Wars, and maybe this time we'd actually get a war, given that the trailer promises a look into the, at this point, only mentioned Clone Wars.
You fought in the Clone Wars?
Yes. I was once a Jedi Knight, the same as your father.
But was the anticipation worth it this time around? Well, the day arrived, May 16th, 2002, and audiences once again rolled up to see Attack of the Clones. And while fans were excited, there was this underlying thought among everyone. Please be better than the last one. As reviews came in after the film's release and fans got a chance to see it, the consensus was clear. It was better than The Phantom Menace. But that didn't mean it was any good. While there were many improvements made, the encounters weren't the same thing over and over again, and the film was a lot smoother than The Phantom Menace, and this time some jokes actually did manage to land. But to be fair, most of them came from C-3PO.
Die, Jedi dogs! What did I say? Now where are you taking me? This is such a drag. I'm quite beside myself.
It was clear to a lot of people that Star Wars wasn't the top dog anymore. Films like The Matrix and Lord of the Rings had now been capturing the minds of audiences like the original trilogy did decades before. That isn't to say the film was unsuccessful, it still made a crap ton of money. But Attack of the Clones was the first time a Star Wars movie didn't top the yearly box office. It was topped by Spider-Man in the domestic box office, and worldwide it was topped by Spider-Man again, Lord of the Rings The Two Towers, and Harry Potter and the Chamber of Secrets. The film was criticized for its coldness, its lack of humanity, and especially for the attempt to have Anakin Skywalker and Padme Amidala fall in love. Roger Ebert said the scenes were filled with cliche and clunky dialogue, all except for...
I don't like sand. It's coarse and rough and irritating. And it gets everywhere. Not like here. Here everything is soft and smooth.
He had to say he hadn't heard that one before. What I will say, however, is that despite the clunkiness of their dialogue and how it's really remarkable that despite his tantrums, she still ends up marrying the guy, John Williams really brought his A-game with the theme. It really has this tragic undertone to it despite being a romantic piece, because we all know how it ends. Anakin becomes Darth Vader, and as said by Princess Leia in Return of the Jedi, Padme dies eventually, and this theme really captures that. Good job, John Williams. Despite its flaws, however, what was felt across the board is that Attack of the Clones had a couple memorable action scenes, some big moments that fans pointed to then and still point to now. The first chase at the start of the movie was fast and exciting, and the landscape was different from any other Star Wars movie. The arena action scene was also a highlight, being largely without music early on, and having the heroes come up with clever ways to get out of their situation without a lightsaber. It was also the first time an army of Jedi were seen, fulfilling the idea that this was the age of the Jedi before the Empire took control in the original trilogy. And Yoda used a lightsaber! Fans were really excited about that one. But a big highlight was the introduction to the clones and their massive and exciting final battle. The action in the movie was among some of the best in Star Wars. Due to the advancements of digital filmmaking, the movie could bring out scale like no other Star Wars movie had before, making these massive armies feel as big as they wanted. As well as the further advancement of ILM's capabilities in visual effects, this was yet another achievement in the technology area in the filmmaking. One thing that is also worth noting, though, is that it's very easy to compare this film to that of Empire Strikes Back, being the second film in the trilogy and all. And while Empire had the earth-shattering reveal that Darth Vader was Luke's father, nothing that shocking was felt in this movie. Not that there had to be something that groundbreaking, but it seems there was an attempt at some kind of reveal, with Count Dooku saying that Darth Sidious, an evil Sith Lord, had control of the Senate. And while Obi-Wan doesn't know, we as an audience know this guy, Chancellor Palpatine, he's the Emperor, he's Darth Sidious in control of the Senate. Dramatic irony at play where the audience knows something the characters don't. Except we've known this since episode 1. Dramatic irony works when used right, but it can only work for so long. But the film was still regarded as a disappointment. It was better than The Phantom Menace, but still wasn't very good on its own. People had soured on the franchise considerably at this point. Maybe Star Wars would never return to its former self. It would never be quite as good as it was before. But not all hope was gone just yet. Episode 3 was set to release in 2005, and maybe this one could stick the landing, bridging the last gap before the original film. After its release, there would be a complete 6-film saga, and that was enticing enough to get audiences excited yet again for the third and final film in the prequel trilogy. In the following 2 years, the production of Episode 3 was far more open about its plot details, considering the fact that people knew how things would ultimately end up, and what the movie had to do to fill the gaps. The Republic had to fall, the Jedi had to die, and Luke and Leia needed to be born. And it was also confirmed that Darth Vader would return in some capacity. Even Samuel L. Jackson, in an interview shortly after the release of Attack of the Clones, said that his character died in the third movie. Spoiler alert! The film was also labeled as the final Star Wars film, given that it was the conclusion to the 6-film saga, and in July 2004 at the Star Wars Comic-Con panel, the title for the final film was revealed. Star Wars Episode 3, Revenge of the Sith. Harkening back to the ultimately unused title Revenge of the Jedi, fans were actually pretty pleased this time around for the title. It actually felt like Star Wars. Perhaps this was a sign. Once again, there could be a truly good Star Wars movie. The teaser trailer was released in November 2004. It showed off some familiar footage from the very first movie, signaling that this was the final piece to the Star Wars puzzle.
A young Jedi named Darth Vader, who was a pupil of mine until he turned to evil, helped the Empire hunt down and destroy the Jedi Knights.
But on top of that, the teaser showed off new footage which would hint at a darker tone. The fall of the Republic, the Jedi, and of course, the return of Darth Vader. This was the one people were waiting for. This was the one people dreamed about when the prequel trilogy was announced 10 years prior. And audiences didn't have to wait that much longer to see the conclusion to the Star Wars saga. In March 2005, in front of the movie Robots, which also stars Ewan McGregor, a second trailer was released. Now, by today's standards, this is not a trailer you'd want to watch. It practically spoils every major plot point. But then again, audiences already knew what had to happen to fill in the gaps before Episode 4, and all this trailer did was confirm that that was what they were gonna see. The promise was clear. On May 19th, the saga would be complete. And so the day arrived, and once again, audiences lined up in droves to see the final installment. People camped outside the theater for hours, even days, playing video games to pass the time. They were gonna be one of the first to see it all end. But one thing was different for this movie. This time it was rated PG-13, while all previous Star Wars movies were rated PG. This was a definitive sign of a darker story, without a truly happy ending. Audiences were excited, but expectations had to be tempered. After all, the last two were not well received, but people's fingers were crossed. Maybe this one would be the good one. The film opened with the classic crawl. This one read a lot more like Star Wars than either of the previous crawls. Then a massive scale battle takes over the opening scene with a new rendition of the Force theme to get audiences into the action. The first 20 minutes of the movie were fast-paced, moving from place to place, blasters, ships, lightsabers. One ship fell into the atmosphere and Anakin had to land it as best he could. The film was exciting again. The action in the first hour was massive and the visual effects were pretty revolutionary, with huge armies of clones, droids, and Wookiees? I mean, that's cool, so I'm not complaining. But while the action was big and intense and got people excited, the scenes in between fell into the same pitfalls as the previous two movies. The dialogue was clunky, the shot composition wasn't particularly lively, and there were a lot of awkward contrivances. One in particular was the resolution of the dramatic irony that Palpatine was the Sith Lord Darth Sidious. Now it's great to see the characters figure it out, but they didn't figure it out. Palpatine got tired of waiting, so he just kinda told them. Yeah, it's me, you got me, heh. What? It's me, I'm the Sith Lord. Wait, really? Yeah, it was pretty obvious. I'm amazed I kept it a secret for this long. But on top of that, at no point, even during the action scenes, did any character really feel like they were in that much of a rush. Oh, there's the Chancellor. Time for a leisurely stroll. Whew, this is a workout. Yo, what's up? Yo, Palpatine's a Sith Lord. Really? If that's true, we need to move immediately. Are we gonna run, or...? But everything changed at the midpoint of the movie, when audiences saw the moment Anakin Skywalker turned to the dark side and became Darth Vader. This is followed by perhaps one of my favorite scenes in the saga, Order 66. The scene is almost completely dialogue-free, allowing the music to take over as clones across the galaxy are ordered to turn against the Jedi and kill them. It's a massive shift. After seeing the Jedi in full force up to this point, they were now swiftly wiped out. It also works due to the darker and more somber tone of the music. John Williams brought a different sound to Star Wars that wasn't heard before, and one moment that I really enjoy that not many people talk about is this. Everything came to a head with the final climactic battle between Obi-Wan and Anakin. Due to their skills, the battle would be swift and decisive. It would be swift and decisive. It would be... Guys, I have to cut to the next thing. The battle was swift and decisive. Usually telling them to stop works. I gotta keep this moving, guys. Okay, see, now they're just making fun of me. While the fight was visually impressive and the visual effects showed off more of ILM's capabilities, the fight goes on for a bit too long. It gets to the point where you forget why they're fighting and just want it to be over. But it does end, and Anakin is burned alive, answering the question of why he needed the suit. Then two scenes are intercut together before the ultimate conclusion, the birth of Luke and Leia and the subsequent death of Padme alongside the birth of Darth Vader. From here, all of the final pieces are put into place. C-3PO and R2-D2 are put on the same ship they were on at the start of Episode 4. Darth Vader and the Emperor stand side by side watching the construction begin on the Death Star. Leia is brought to Alderaan with Bail Organa and his wife. And Luke is brought to his aunt and uncle on Tatooine, where they look out towards the binary sunset. The movie and the saga as a whole ends where it began, completing the journey. And as the credits rolled, audiences felt a wave of satisfaction. They now had the complete saga. That isn't to say audiences weren't still critical of the movie. They definitely pointed out the film's shortcomings, but the list wasn't quite as long as the previous two movies. And the positives vastly outweighed the other prequels. This wasn't the fantastic Star Wars movie people were hoping for, but at least it wasn't absolutely terrible. And with the complete saga, a new generation of audiences grew up knowing the saga as six films. This included me. I grew up knowing the six films and I liked them all, as well as the entire generation around me. But that was it for the Star Wars saga. While the franchise would continue in supplementary material, the idea of another feature film didn't seem like it was really in the cards, despite some saying it would be an inevitability. But if it did happen, it wouldn't be anytime soon. George Lucas himself said,
"There is no episode 7.
So audiences were left with this ultimate conclusion, and while people poke fun at the tying up of loose ends a little too neatly, I'm mostly fine with it, except for 3PO getting his mind wiped, that might be a little too much. But the promised six-film saga had now come to fruition, and it was time to let Star Wars be a part of the past. It was time to let go. Star Wars had had its day. Maybe it would come back, but audiences were satisfied enough with where it ended. And so that was the end of the Star Wars saga. And in the immortal words of George Lucas, there is no episode 7. Nah, we ain't done yet. In the years following Revenge of the Sith, Star Wars never truly left the public conscience. Supplementary material like books, video games, and the Clone Wars TV show were still popular. The Clone Wars itself introduced a number of now fan-favorite characters like Ahsoka Tano, Captain Rex, among many others through its run, being a new entry point for young fans into the franchise. But there was no word on any future installment theatrically. But in the fall of 2010, it was announced that the six-film saga was going to be re-released to theaters, and in the wake of Avatar and the boom of 3D movies, each film was going to be redone in 3D. Starting in 2012 with The Phantom Menace, the films would release once every year until 2017 with Return of the Jedi, and they would subsequently be released on Blu-ray. So the time came, the year 2012. In February, The Phantom Menace was re-released to theaters, this time in 3D. And there were some other changes made this time around. The most notable was that the puppet Yoda was replaced with the CGI Yoda used in episodes 2 and 3. Overall, while the success wasn't absolutely massive, it was still considerable given that it was episode 1, a film people had seen before and largely disliked. But Lucasfilm was pretty upbeat about the re-release and were excited to continue releasing the rest of the saga over the course of the next 6 years. Hold on, we're getting a major alert. It appears that Disney just bought Lucasfilm and they're making episode 7? Oh! Screw your 3D re-releases, it's time for new Star Wars movies! Episode 7 is coming in 2015 with episode 8 and 9 shortly after. Holy crap, this is massive! The complete 9-film saga promised so long ago is now finally going to happen. Now with Disney at the helm, George Lucas decided to hand off the franchise to a new owner, and had laid out his ideas for the next 3 installments. Reactions to this varied. There were naysayers who thought Disney would inevitably ruin the franchise, despite the fact that the original movies would still exist and people already didn't like the prequels. Overwhelmingly, however, reactions were incredibly positive. Star Wars was coming back, but people had to be skeptical. While it was rumored that Mark Hamill, Carrie Fisher, and Harrison Ford would return, along with a new, younger cast, Star Wars had been disappointing before, and audiences needed to keep expectations tempered. But people couldn't help but get excited. The idea of seeing what happened after Return of the Jedi was something theorized since 1983, with many books, comics, and other material written about the next adventures. And now, it was finally coming to the big screen. Episode 7 was finally happening. Theories spread across the internet. A lot of questions were thrown around, but one major one was, who would direct Episode 7? Directors like Joss Whedon and Jon Favreau were considered, as well as J.J. Abrams at one point, but he turned it down, saying he'd rather be a fan watching the movies and be involved in making them. But also some unorthodox picks were Ben Affleck, Zack Snyder, even Tarantino's name was thrown around. But in January of 2013, it was officially announced that J.J. Abrams would helm Episode 7. Clearly he changed his mind, or he was simply saying that he didn't want to do it to get people off of his scent. Either way, he was set to helm the next installment, which was confirmed to release on December 18th, 2015, the first of the Star Wars films to be released during the holiday season. Excitement was ramping up, articles were published over every piece of information that could be gleaned, even if it was completely bogus. But in the year 2014, some official information began to arise. The first of which came in April of 2014 with the cast announcement. It not only confirmed that Mark Hamill, Harrison Ford, and Carrie Fisher would return to reprise their iconic roles of Luke, Han, and Leia, but it also confirmed the new faces of Star Wars. Daisy Ridley, John Boyega, Oscar Isaac, among many others, were announced as the new generation of Star Wars. While the actors were revealed, the characters they played were a mystery, which led to this fan-made poster. Which in hindsight is pretty hilarious, I'm gonna be real with you. Over the summer of 2014, fans got little glimpses as the movie was shooting throughout the year. They got a look at some of the creatures and an X-Wing, proving that this film would be more focused on practical effects as opposed to the CGI-heavy prequels. On November 6, 2014, it was announced that The Force Awakens had wrapped production— Wait, The Force Awakens? Aw, man, they just nonchalantly revealed the title of Episode 7. Star Wars: The Force Awakens. This truly felt like a return to form for Star Wars titles. It had an air of mystery to it. What did it mean? Was the Force gone? Did it have to come back? Did the Force have to awaken in someone? People were curious. A few weeks later, while none of those questions were answered, the first look at The Force Awakens came out with the teaser trailer, which even now still gets me excited. It was quick, it was brief, all it needed to do was show off some imagery, and confirm that this was really happening. Some criticized the teaser for showing too little, they wanted to see the original cast members, but others praised it for getting them excited with barely any information. Another remark was that it's clearly not directed by George Lucas. The camera is always moving, it has that J.J. Abrams seal of intensity to it. Fans were excited, but they had a year to wait to see the next chapter in the Star Wars saga. This was a busy year for Star Wars. Not only was The Force Awakens going to be the main attraction at the end of the year and all of the marketing that would come with that, but information was revealed about what would come after. Disney announced that they were planning to make what are known as anthology films, with two in the works in secret. These would be theatrical releases that, while set in the same universe, weren't connected to the Skywalker story, instead focusing on the smaller aspects of the universe. The first anthology film was announced, titled Rogue One, A Star Wars Story, set for release in December 2016, 1 year after The Force Awakens. The cast was revealed along with a short synopsis. It was going to follow a ragtag group of rebels stealing the Death Star plans before Episode 4. But on top of Rogue One, the new trilogy was taking shape. Rian Johnson was confirmed to write and direct Episode 8, set to release in May of 2017, and Colin Trevorrow was set to direct Episode 9 in 2019, with Rian Johnson reportedly returning to write that one as well. While fans had a lot to look forward to, all eyes were on the immediate future, Episode 7, and in April of 2015, a second teaser was released for The Force Awakens. This time hinting at more of the story, with narration from Luke Skywalker sending chills down fans' spines. More looks at the Millennium Falcon, Stormtroopers, the new characters, and of course, Han Solo and Chewbacca.
Chewie, we're home.
This undoubtedly got fans super excited. They finally had a glimpse of some returning cast members for Star Wars Episode 7, and hype was only beginning to ramp up for the seventh film. July of 2015 saw Comic-Con. New information was teased about Rogue One. Han Solo prequel was announced to be directed by Phil Lord and Chris Miller, and a behind-the-scenes reel was shown from The Force Awakens, promising practical effects over CGI, blending new and old technology.
To see the way the technology has evolved, and yet keeping one foot in the pre-digital world.
This was super promising for fans. After the CGI-heavy prequels, it was time to see something that was tangible and real, just like the original trilogy. October of 2015 saw yet another trailer, which still confirmed no real new details other than Finn holding a lightsaber. Holy cow, he's gonna be a Jedi. He's gonna go stormtrooper to Jedi in this movie. And that's a pretty big leap. I mean, I don't know how they're going to be able to do it. But another major point of speculation was the whereabouts of Luke Skywalker. He wasn't in the marketing. Perhaps he was the villain. Whatever the deal was, it had to be seen when the film was released. In true J.J. Abrams fashion, fans still didn't really know a whole lot of new details about The Force Awakens. And it seemed that despite only being 2 months out from release, this movie seemed so out of reach. But December of 2015 did arrive, and with it a massive Star Wars media blitz. Fans were incredibly excited, the trailers were fantastic, the nostalgia was overwhelming, and it actually looked like a movie far more promising than the prequels. But people had been disappointed before. The excitement crossed with anxiety was palpable in the days leading up to the film's release. But this didn't stop people from going out to see the movie opening weekend, making it the largest opening weekend in film history. The film was financially successful, but one question remained. Was the movie any good? Well, yes. The movie gets going immediately, running from place to place, meeting fun new characters, reintroducing new things in exciting ways while also reinventing the old, and finding new ways to bring them in.
Ah! What about that ship?
That was garbage! The garbage will do!
The new characters were front and center. Fans got to know the characters of Rey, Finn, and Poe, the new trio, while also getting another visit from fan favorites like Han Solo, Chewbacca, and General Leia. The action was fast and intense, the TIE fighter breakout at the beginning being a highlight for me, where in the theater I realized that I was actually there, I was watching the new Star Wars movie. It's an amazing feeling. But possibly another one of my favorite sequences throughout the entire saga was the Millennium Falcon chase. It's fast, the ships are moving at 100 miles an hour, and so is the camera. You're doing your best to keep up as the movie whips you around. Rey, Finn, and Poe Dameron were incredibly fun characters, despite Poe getting the least amount of screen time out of the three of them. Audiences rooted for them and got invested in their struggle, and more importantly, wanted to see more. BB-8 was a technical marvel. The mechanics of getting that thing to work is beyond me, but he's also just stupid fun.
Get us there as fast as you can.
I'll drop you to the Nima Terminal.
But a definite highlight was the new villain, Kylo Ren, who turned out to be Han and Leia's son, Ben Solo. His conflict, his want to remain on the dark side, to be as strong as Darth Vader, his grandfather, while being tugged to the light because of his parents and uncle, was a really interesting new dynamic for the main villain in a Star Wars movie.
You're afraid that you will never be as strong as Darth Vader.
He's unstable, and it all comes to a head when he kills Han Solo. The famous character that arguably made Harrison Ford's career was swiftly killed off. Many had speculated it would happen, but that didn't mean it hurt any less when it did. I had an inkling before seeing it, but once I saw Han and Kylo Ren on the bridge, I knew it was an inevitability. The final lightsaber fight showed off a new take on the climactic duels. After the over-choreographed fights in the prequel trilogy, it was back to basics. The sabers felt heavy, they had weight to them, and they lit the area. Lighting the characters' faces, it was a brutal new take on lightsaber fights. But this fight contains what is probably my favorite moment in the Star Wars saga. Finn has been taken down, the Skywalker lightsaber has gotten stuck in the snow. Kylo Ren tries to grab it, it flies out of the ground past him. Who will it go to? Will it go to Luke? Is this where he arrives? No. It flies into Rey's hand. The smile on my face every time I see it. After Rey had been testing her abilities in the Force, she now shows off her true strength. And after hearing the word Force, she focuses and defeats Kylo Ren, slicing his face. With a climactic escape, the Resistance has hit the First Order right where they live. But the one question still remained. Where was Luke Skywalker? The entire movie, people are after the map to his location. The crawl opens with Luke Skywalker has vanished. Well, the final minutes of the movie show R2-D2 completing the map and joining Rey and Chewbacca to journey to him. After scaling a large mountain, Rey finds Luke Skywalker and holds out the saber to him. Luke simply stares back in silence. The look on his face says so much. But that is where the credits roll and audiences everywhere said, now I gotta see episode 8. So I guess that's why Luke wasn't in the trailers, because he wasn't in the movie. Fans were ecstatic coming out of The Force Awakens, a big, fast, energetic, and exciting new Star Wars movie. Finally, for the first time since 1983, a new Star Wars movie was truly good. That didn't mean the movie was flawless. Criticisms were leveled at its similarity to Episode 4, specifically the inclusion of a third Death Star, which was already a tired plot in Return of the Jedi. However, there was some forgiveness for the similarity. After the different and not well-received prequel trilogy, it was time to go back to basics, and J.J. Abrams was the guy to go to replicate the feeling of the original Star Wars. Fans' only hope was that after this, the franchise wouldn't double down, but instead it would go in a new and bold direction in the future. But excitement was at an all-time high, and questions started being raised. Who is Rey? Who are her parents? Who is her family? Who is Snoke? Is he actually 20 feet tall, or is he like 2 feet tall and just pretends to be big to be intimidating? Is he Darth Plagueis, the mysterious Sith Lord that could create life? Is Rey a virgin in the Force like Anakin Skywalker? I guess this is what you get for opening the J.J. Abrams mystery box, huh? One thing was clear, however. Star Wars had just entered an exciting new era, a promising new era. Good Star Wars movies were back, and it was time to get excited for the future once again. While initial reactions to The Force Awakens were mainly positive, a deep, festering underbelly of Star Wars fans began to resurface. The Force Awakens is the worst movie of all time. Accompanied with this thumbnail, Star Wars The Force Awakens, an unbridled rage. Why, Star Wars The Force Awakens is a massive disappointment. The Force Awakens, great movie, bad sequel. What does that even mean, man? I mean, I'm sure not all of these creators are the worst, except Mahler, he sucks. His introduction to his Force Awakens review is longer than the movie itself. Now I would delve into the topic of the toxic side of Star Wars endlessly bullying the cast and creators, going back to the prequels where they even bullied George Lucas to the point of selling his company and not wanting to make any more Star Wars movies, and then they have the audacity to ask him back for Episode 9. I would dive into all that, but I don't want to give them the light of day. Besides, they hadn't fully come out of the woodwork just yet. Now, while they were whining about nothing, everyone else was getting excited about the future. While Episode 8 was delayed from May 2017 to December 2017, that didn't stop people from getting excited for the continuation of the saga, with a production announcement in February 2016 generating some more excitement.
Get cover. Beautiful.
Meanwhile, Alden Ehrenreich was cast as the young Han Solo in the prequel film set to release May 2018, and Colin Trevorrow wanted to film Episode 9 in space. So that's fun. But eyes turned towards the immediate future when the first teaser to Rogue One came out in April 2016. With it being the first anthology film, audiences were undoubtedly excited, but they were mainly curious. After The Force Awakens played it relatively safe, it was time for Disney to really take a chance. It was time to take a detour from the regular episodic Star Wars movies, and so far the movie looked great. It was going to be a gritty, boots-on-the-ground war movie, and it felt completely different than anything else in the Star Wars universe. But some fears set in a couple months later with the announcement of reshoots. While this wasn't cause for concern, as The Force Awakens went into the same amount of reshoots a year prior, and that turned out okay, but it was the reasoning that was reported, stating that Disney thought Rogue One wasn't as good as Force Awakens and wanted to lighten the mood. Some fears began to arise, but were quickly dashed when Comic-Con arrived with another behind-the-scenes reel. This time once again promising the use of practical effects over CGI and the benefits of using practical effects, as well as Gareth Edwards, the director, saying that he wanted to bring something new to the table with Star Wars. Excitement ramped up again as a second trailer was released in August of 2016. While it merely confirmed what people already knew, the movie would look amazing. Gareth Edwards' signature visual effects and scale would be awe-inspiring, but also, the end of the trailer confirmed something fans were already 99% sure about, but it was nice to get confirmation, and that was the reveal of Darth Vader. It's amazing that 2 seconds at the back of his helmet and half a breath made fans go, you know, like this. October 2016 saw yet another trailer, this time delving into Jyn Erso's family, specifically her father Galen Erso, who was instrumental to the creation of the Death Star, and that's why she was involved in the story. Now, when I first saw this trailer back then, I thought, whoa, TMI. Felt like a lot more than I wanted to hear. But overall, the trailer was still exciting. It showed off more of the exciting action and further teases of Darth Vader. Fast forward 2 months, and it's time to see what the first anthology film would look like. Now, when I went to see it, the theater I was at just finished a previous screening of Rogue One before I went in, and I overheard a guy talking to his group of friends saying, "I can't believe how good that was." Now, you can imagine that's an amazing thing to hear about the movie I was about to see, but the question remained, was he right? Well, first things first, the movie just starts. There is no title crawl this time around, cementing the difference between this and the mainline films. On top of the differences, there is not a single screen wipe in the entire movie, a signature of Star Wars. On top of that, it was the first film to use location headers to help the audience follow the story. Now, this was more due to the fact that the movie jumped around a lot in the first 30 minutes. A lot of locations, a lot of characters, but it eventually found its footing. Over the course of the movie, it settled into the strongest aspects, which were the visual effects and action set pieces, especially in the third act, which contains one of, if not the best, space battle in all of Star Wars. On top of that, Gareth Edwards' deft use of scale is on display in full force this time around, with the Death Star looking massive, AT-ATs looking massive. It's fun to try and reverse engineer what makes it work so well, so the movie has that going for it. On top of that, some of the shots are just magnificent.
It's well hidden and unstable. One blast to any part of it will destroy the entire station.
As well as the ultimate fan explosion of seeing two Star Destroyers crash into each other, I mean, it looks amazing. But while the visual effects and action scenes were a definite highlight, the characters that populated them were less interesting. The film had a large ensemble cast filled with talented actors, and while they all get a lot to do, none of them seem to get enough. They all seem one step away from becoming fully fledged characters, and the actors are doing good work with what they're given, but I can't honestly remember half of the characters' names, and I just saw the movie. There's Jyn Erso, there's Cassian Andor, there's the pilot, there's the blind guy, the machine gun guy, and, oh yeah, K2SO. Yeah, he's good.
Jyn, I'll be there for you. Cassian said I had to.
Ah, whoops, now he's dead. And so is everyone else. Whoop, there they go. The major spoiler to come out of this movie was the fact that every main character died at the end, which despite the underwritten characters, their deaths were largely successful. Except the pilot totally could have thrown the grenade away, like, dude. Now I guess I should talk about the elephant in the room, and that is Darth Vader. While he isn't in the movie that much, he's still pretty gray, right? There's a lot of attention to detail on his suit, the red lenses, the scuffs, everything to make it look just as it did in A New Hope. But also the hallway scene at the end, where he just walks down the hallway and mows down rebels. There's nothing to it, it's simply meant to get a reaction out of the fan part of you, but it works. I mean, what can I say? Although it would be nice for people to stop asking for this to be an entire movie, it really only sustains itself for 2 minutes before the idea kinda dies off. And for some, it didn't really sustain itself for that, being too heavy on the fan service. But the Death Star plans do get away and are handed to Princess Leia as they jump to hyperspace to the beginning of the first Star Wars movie. This entire movie was a love letter to the original, and a fairly successful one at that. And overall, critical reception was quite positive. There were some criticisms of the flat characters and some others saying the movie didn't really add to the universe, aside from fixing the exhaust port plot hole. And another criticism was the questionable act of resurrecting Peter Cushing with CGI. Now, while I think it's a technical achievement, despite it sitting in the uncanny valley, it's pretty amazing that they can resurrect a dead actor with CGI. But also, they resurrected a dead actor with CGI. I mean, The music was also a point of discussion, as it was the first time John Williams didn't do the music to a Star Wars movie. And while I think it's impressive that despite only having so long to make the score, Michael Giacchino made a decent score anyway, but it wasn't quite as memorable, probably due to time constraints, as the other scores in the series. and some felt the reshoots and re-edits to be quite obvious, with some looking at the trailers and seeing all the footage that never made it into the movie. The most obvious conclusion was that the third act was heavily altered after the fact, given that most of the missing footage seemed to come from that section of the movie. One moment that I always see is at the end when Cassian Andor opens his eyes before getting blown up. Now, some might not care, but to me it looks like they just said cut, so the actor's opening his eyes again. It seemed like a crack in the otherwise rather smooth re-edit and reshooting of the movie. But fans were definitely satisfied with where the movie landed, giving them references, callbacks, and fun moments that harken back to the original, and even the prequels at times. While it wasn't perfect, it was a promising start to the anthology side of the Star Wars universe, and it left people with hope for the future of Star Wars spin-offs, with the next one being the Han Solo prequel in 2018. However, in the end of 2016, the tragic news broke that Carrie Fisher had passed away. She had been a beacon of light for decades, and while she had finished her scenes in Episode 8, and people had one last Leia performance to look forward to, the hole left by her passing was felt then and is still felt now. All I can say is, may the Force be with you. Rest in peace, Carrie Fisher. In the wake of the tragic news, the higher-ups at Disney and Lucasfilm began to think about how to deal with the passing of Carrie Fisher and the future of Leia in the Star Wars universe. It was widely reported that the original plan was that Episode 9 was to be the Leia movie, much like Episode 7 was the Han Solo movie and Episode 8 was shaping up to be the Luke movie. So questions were raised on how to deal with the character without Carrie Fisher. Thankfully, digital resurrection a la Tarkin was not on the table. But Carrie Fisher was to have a larger role in Episode 8, which in January of 2017 was revealed to be called Star Wars: The Last Jedi. The title sent shockwaves across the internet. Questions were raised everywhere. Who is the Last Jedi? Is Jedi singular or plural? Is it Luke? Is it Rey? Is it both of them? Is it actually Snoke? Is that the curveball? All of these questions and more were asked, but none were answered as showcased by the Josh Gad Instagram videos where he jokingly berates Daisy Ridley into giving him Star Wars details on the set of Murder on the Orient Express, even getting Judi Dench involved at one point. My personal favorite moment is in the final video, which has a collection of famous actors asking Star Wars questions, but one person in particular appears at the very end to ask a very important question.
Does Luke finally get to say any lines in Episode 8? Please tell me, Daisy.
But soon, questions would be answered, as April 2017 saw Star Wars Celebration, which celebrated the 40-year anniversary of Star Wars, as well as this touching video in tribute to Carrie Fisher. But there was also a Last Jedi panel, where once again Josh Gad tries to get answers from Daisy Ridley to no avail. But they did reveal a teaser poster, huh? Isn't that great? Yeah, right, a teaser poster. What do you mean you wanted more? It's a poster. It's really cool. All right. Fine, there's a trailer too. The teaser release answered almost no questions, but showed our returning characters and hinted at the big new action scenes and new worlds in the new film. But the most shocking moment was when Luke said,
"It's time for the Jedi to end."
This was surely shocking to hear. After spending all of The Force Awakens trying to get to Luke, all he wants to do is end the Jedi? Aw, man, I gotta see this movie. With The Last Jedi taking most of fans' attention, more and more questions were asked about how the story might unfold. But all of a sudden, people were looking elsewhere with the surprising announcement that Phil Lord and Chris Miller were fired from the Han Solo movie. They were swiftly replaced by Ron Howard, which seemed to show Disney's lack of wanting to take the franchise in a really new place. But reportedly, the set under Lord and Miller was an absolute mess, and hiring Ron Howard was a breath of fresh air. Concern really started circulating around the Han Solo film, changing directors in the middle of filming with less than a year until release, as well as it being reported that Alden Ehrenreich needed an acting coach on set. Things were not shaping up well for the Han Solo film. But The Last Jedi was still looking good, with D23 showcasing a behind-the-scenes reel in July 2017. Instead of showcasing the use of practical effects like the previous two movies, it focused more on the story and the unexpected direction it was going in. This was certainly exciting, as fans' main criticism was that The Force Awakens was too similar to A New Hope, and some worried that The Last Jedi would follow too close to Empire Strikes Back, but it seemed likely that that was not going to be the case. So overall, it seemed the sequel trilogy was shaping up nicely. Oh my god, Colin Trevorrow was just fired from Episode 9. Well, I guess shooting in space wasn't a great idea after all. He was swiftly replaced by J.J. Abrams, who would return to direct as well as co-write alongside Chris Terrio, who was credited with writing... Oh, I've got a bad feeling about this. With the film delayed from May 2019 to December 2019, it was still unclear what was going to happen in Episode 9, given that Episode 8 had yet to arrive. But a second trailer to The Last Jedi arrived in October 2017, which didn't reveal too much information, only more looks at the characters and expanding upon what was already known from the first teaser, as well as showing some more action and a potential alliance between Rey and Kylo Ren? What? But the most shocking element of the trailer was that it seemed to show the death of Leia.
That's the only way to become what you were meant to be.
While we all knew the real-world scenario, they wouldn't reveal that in the trailer, would they? Well, I guess time would tell, as December was right around the corner and people were once again getting excited for the continuation of the Star Wars saga. As excitement for The Last Jedi was ramping up, Ron Howard revealed the title for the Han Solo film, with its title being Solo, a Star Wars story. You probably could have guessed that one.
Yep.
But there was no time to focus on Solo, as December 2017 had arrived and it was time for Star Wars Episode 8, The Last Jedi. Now before I go in to see the movie, let me check out some review. Oh my god, what the holy crap, what is happening? There's so much salt. There's so much salt. Reactions to The Last Jedi were incredibly divisive, with some absolutely loving it and others absolutely hating it. I guess the only way to figure out what happened is to watch the movie. Well, returning to mainline tradition, the film opens with another crawl, but unlike the other films, it picks up right where The Force Awakens left off, and doesn't take a moment to breathe, with a big, fast action sequence to get the movie started in an exciting way, followed soon after by slowing down to see Rey handing the lightsaber to Luke. This is how the last movie ended. This moment has sat unresolved for 2 years. Now it's time to see, what is Luke going to do? Oh. I didn't expect that. Yes, The Last Jedi prides itself on being unexpected, taking things in new directions and doing new things with characters that wasn't the first prediction after The Force Awakens released. And yes, Luke Skywalker drinks green milk kinda angrily, but honestly, it's not that bad, guys. This movie's pretty good, actually. I mean... With exciting action and big moments, the film is moving from place to place with so many big and small things worth discussing throughout the entire film. One thing that stuck out was that the film had a lot more humor than previous Star Wars movies. It was chock full of a lot more jokes. And while humor is integral to Star Wars, this film took it up a notch, which is nothing to complain about. Most of the humor works, the timing is often on point, but the handful of jokes that don't land stick out like a sore thumb. A big moment, however, was the scene from the trailer that looked like Leia's death. She is blown out of the ship, but not by Kylo Ren, and she seemingly dies, but she ends up using the Force to pull herself back in. Now, this does look kinda goofy, I will say that, but it was still an unexpected and different moment in Star Wars. I can give this movie that. At no point was I able to see what would happen next. Everything was unexpected, and that was refreshing. But Leia is left unconscious, which leads to a side plot with Finn and a new character named Rose. They journey to Canto Bight, a casino planet. This was arguably the most agreed-upon aspect of the film, as in... this part kinda sucks. It dragged things down and grinds it to a halt. And the horse chase isn't particularly exciting, but it shows the guts of Rian Johnson to put something like that into the film. It isn't really supposed to make sense until the very end, so you're left thinking it isn't great in the moment. Kinda the opposite take to J.J. Abrams, who prefers momentary entertainment as opposed to looking at the big picture. But it would have been nice to have something to grasp onto in the moment, because as it stands, it seems like more of a distraction from the most interesting aspects of the film. But Rose is overall a fun character, she's enjoyable, and I hope to see more from her in the future. Admiral Holdo was a point of contention coming out of the movie. It seems she immediately antagonizes Poe Dameron, and she's painted as a bad guy for the entire movie until such point as her risky plan ends up working. But it's kind of jarring, especially after The Force Awakens showed the Resistance standing around a table all pitching ideas on how to defeat Starkiller Base. But this movie's trying to do different things, and it overall works. Holdo is definitely justified in not letting Poe in on the idea, given that Poe actually tries to screw it all up anyway. And in the end, Holdo had the good idea and the plan would have worked if it weren't for them being sold out, which they couldn't have planned. But what was actually great about the movie was the connection between Rey and Kylo Ren through the Force. It was an interesting new use of the Force, bridging their minds. They can talk to each other, even touch each other, from across the galaxy and still not know where the other one is. Their dynamic on top of Luke Skywalker is the most interesting aspect of the film. Luke especially. He's a hermit. He wants nothing to do with the conflict because he's the one who created it. He feels he failed because expectations about him were sky high. He's Luke Skywalker, the legend. And he felt he couldn't live up to it, as well as being afraid of others following his failure. And this is why he wants the Jedi to end, because he sees their failure, their endless failure, going back generations. But a chat with Yoda often clears the mind, doesn't it? And I mean, Yoda's great. He uses the Force to lightning strike a tree, even though he's dead. I mean, that's just amazing. It finally made good on the promise of,
if you strike me down, I shall become more powerful than you can possibly imagine.
Every time I see the Yoda scene in this movie, I have a dumb grin on my face. It's the first time since Return of the Jedi that Yoda actually lit up the screen. Literally, in this case.
The sacred Jedi texts!
Oh, read them, have you? Well, I'm page-turners. They were not.
Yoda can once again give Luke some much-needed advice, as well as telling the audience the theme of the movie.
The greatest teacher failure is... We are what they grow beyond. That is the true burden of all masters.
But after this, the three plot lines become intertwined, with Poe leading a mutiny on the Resistance ship, Finn, Rose, and DJ getting closer to disabling the lightspeed tracker, and Rey meeting with Snoke. This is the point that the movie really comes into its own. It puts all its cards on the table. Well, all but one. Finn, Rose, and DJ fail to disable the tracker. Poe is stunned by the recently awakened Leia, leaving control to Admiral Holdo. But the most shocking part was that Kylo Ren kills Snoke? All those questions you had about who he was, that doesn't matter. Snoke is dead. He was simply an obstacle in the way of the real villain, which is Kylo Ren. But the throne room fight? Pick it apart all you want. It's still awesome. This scene comes to a head with Kylo Ren revealing that Rey's parents were nobody but filthy drunk traders who sold her for drinking money. This is the worst thing that Rey can hear about her own lineage. She's nobody, but she's still super powerful and has the ability to save her friends. It makes the Force magic again. No more midi-chlorians or lineage, it's just magic. And that's great. But this is followed by what is probably the most visually amazing thing to come out of Star Wars, with a major climactic point before the third act. Kylo offers Rey his hand, she declines, and they destroy the Skywalker lightsaber. Finn and Rose are nearly executed, but Holdo uses the ship and jumps into hyperspace through Snoke's ship. I mean, do I need to say more? Followed thereafter by a massive third act Battle of Crait, which is visually distinct from anything else in Star Wars, with the red being spilled from the ground with every footstep, every explosion. It's jam-packed with a ton of big moments and little moments. But there's also another Millennium Falcon TIE fighter chase through the caves, somewhat reminiscent of Return of the Jedi. Huh. But the battle doesn't end well, with Rose stopping Finn from sacrificing himself, and instead the Resistance being exposed. It seems all hope is lost. But here comes Luke Skywalker, and he looks different. His hair is darker. I guess he went to the barber or something, I don't know. This is followed by a touching scene with Luke and Leia, which reprises their theme that up until now was only used in Return of the Jedi.
I know what you're gonna say. I changed my hair.
It's nice that way.
But Luke walks out and stands before the First Order, the exact thing he said he wasn't going to do at the start of the movie. This is chill-inducing. He stands before them and stops them in their tracks. But he's blown up. Oh no, Luke Skywalker is dead. Nope, he's alive, and he just shrugs it off. That's pretty cool. Then comes a climactic fight between Luke and Kylo Ren, where their blades never touch once. And Luke is using the destroyed saber? What? Kylo Ren then gets enraged, slicing through Luke. The Kylo Ren theme is turned up to 11. Luke Skywalker just... Wait, no he didn't. Oh my god, Luke Skywalker is a hologram. He's force projecting from the other side of the galaxy to save the Resistance. He gets to be Luke the Legend and allows the Resistance to escape the First Order. That's neat. But that much power comes at a cost, and in looking out towards another binary sunset, Luke fades away, becoming one with the Force. It's a very well done end to his character. After 40 years of following Luke Skywalker, this was a great way to end his arc. And with a message of hope about the future of the Resistance and the future of the Force, the film ends, leaving a lot of questions open as to how this would all conclude in Episode 9. The Last Jedi is good, stop whining. It's energetic, it's fun, and it dives a lot deeper into the characters, taking them into new and exciting directions, and doing new things with them. The only character's arc that I didn't really like was Finn. Not that I disliked it, but it's essentially the same arc as The Force Awakens, just on a bigger scale. He also doesn't need to be told that people are negatively impacted by the war, because he was taken as a child to fight in said wars, so I'm sure he's well aware. But Rey, Luke, and Kylo Ren were definite highlights, with Rose being a promising new character as well. Oh yeah, and Captain Phasma. Yeah, I mean, if you expected Captain Phasma to do something and were disappointed when she died, I mean, that's kind of on you. But it would be really fun if in all three movies Captain Phasma showed up, did something for 2 minutes, and then died. I feel like that just could have been a really dumb idea that I'd be game for. But the toxic side of the Star Wars fandom came out in full force, with more toxicity, more anger, and more attacking of the cast and creators, which is still going 3 years later. Oh my god, this pandemic needs to end so these people can go outside for once. The Last Jedi isn't perfect, but it's a damn good entry into the series, and if you don't like it, that's fine, but like, my guy, stop complaining about it. The film was certainly a bit rocky with me early on. It's not something that you can put on a Sunday afternoon. It takes some getting used to, but after a couple years, I've learned to enjoy it a lot more, respecting the stuff I really like and looking past the stuff I don't really like, because the high points are so unbelievably high that the stuff I don't care much about fades into the background. But with The Last Jedi now released, having shaken up the sequel trilogy in new ways, there is only one more mainline film left to complete the once-promised 9-film saga. Before that, however, it was time for a second spin-off only a few months later. 2018 got off to a rocky start. The division among fans quickly turned calm conversations into immediate brawls based on whether you liked or disliked The Last Jedi. Many began to claim that Star Wars was no longer fun to talk about, as every conversation inevitably ended up in an argument over a simple disagreement. Like how I think Snoke's ship in The Last Jedi would make an awesome Lego set, and someone else would be like, no. And then we'd fight or something, I don't know. But to be fair, it would make a great Lego set. I mean, look at that thing. There wasn't much time to breathe after The Last Jedi, however, as Solo, A Star Wars Story was set to release in May 2018, leaving only a 5-month gap between the two movies, the smallest gap between any two Star Wars movies. And while Solo was getting closer, there was no trailer. There was no footage. Some thought it might be due to wanting to keep attention on The Last Jedi, but others felt it was due to the behind-the-scenes troubles the film was facing. But February 2018 saw a 45-second Super Bowl spot, the first look at the movie. It was followed the day after by a full teaser trailer. The overall impression of the teaser was that it did alleviate some of the concern over the movie, but not all of it. Solo was easily the least anticipated movie of this generation of Star Wars movies, and the trailer didn't seem to really get people excited. But some moments in the teaser were fun and showed some promise.
Thought we were in trouble there for a second, but it's fine. We're fine.
Some even commented that the film had a similar feeling to that of American Graffiti, which is doubly ironic considering that Ron Howard was in American Graffiti. Him and George Lucas are longtime friends, so it all comes full circle. The teaser also showed glimpses of the Millennium Falcon, which not only looked slightly different on the outside, but also incredibly clean on the inside. Like, what the hell happened? What did Han do to turn the Falcon into, well...
What a piece of junk!
And while the Solo film was the major Star Wars event of the year, there was still some word about what would come in the near future outside of the films, with it being announced that Jon Favreau was to write and produce a live-action series set between Return of the Jedi and The Force Awakens. Not much was known about it other than the fact that it had debuted with Disney's new streaming service sometime in 2019. Meanwhile, April 2018 saw a second trailer for Solo, this time showing more footage, more action, more excitement, and more humor.
What do you think? Well, what do you know?
Despite the more energetic trailer, there still wasn't much excitement for Solo. It was only cautious optimism that kept people going until the end of May. There was still a lot of worry over the production issues, and on top of that, some people weren't sold on the idea of making a movie about Han Solo. It didn't seem very interesting. And the trailer hinted that maybe it was going to be a greatest hits montage, showing us how Han Solo got all the things that made him recognizable. How he got his blaster, how he met Chewbacca, the Kessel Run, but nothing new to grasp onto. Simply showing stuff that we've already heard about. But for nothing else, the movie still looked enjoyable at the very least, and soon enough, May 2018 arrived, and people turned out in droves. They did not turn out in droves to see Solo. Kind of jumped the gun on that one. Whoops. After the previous three Star Wars movies all topped the domestic and worldwide box office for each respective year, Solo massively underperformed at the box office. It made it to the number 12 spot domestically, while falling all the way down to the number 23 spot worldwide for 2018. Why, though? Well, for one thing, even though it was Star Wars, there were simply other movies that were more interesting to large audiences that were coming out at the same time. Avengers Infinity War, Deadpool 2, Incredibles 2, Jurassic World 2. That's a lot of 2. I mean, maybe if they called it Solo 2, we'd be alright. I mean, but nothing really seemed to get butts into seats. The Star Wars brand didn't carry the same weight this time around. It also seemed to come too soon after The Last Jedi, which was already a touchy subject. Maybe Solo should have been pushed back to December. The rampant rumors and behind-the-scenes troubles also had a hand in making people worried, with fans crossing their fingers and preparing for the worst. But was the fear justified? Is it a total colossal mess? Is the movie actually any good? Yeah, it's alright. At its best, Solo was a fun ride with some good characters, some good action, and a lot of humor to sustain 2 hours of entertainment. And unlike The Last Jedi or Rogue One, you can put this one on a Sunday afternoon and forget about it once it's over. At its worst, Solo is like a Wikipedia article put on film, with it feeling a lot like a checklist of all the things that we know about Han Solo. How he met Chewbacca, how he got his blaster, how he met Lando, how he got the Falcon, as well as some questions that weren't being asked, like where did Han Solo get his name? Well, it turns out the name Solo was given to him from some Imperial guy who could not give less of a crap. So I guess that's just how that is now. That's cool. But while the checklist feel certainly doesn't help the film, some of the execution of these ideas is pretty solid. Alden Ehrenreich is doing a good job as Han Solo. He's not doing an impression of Harrison Ford, he's bringing his own spin to it. But at the same time, he's still got the same attitude as the character did in the original trilogy.
I knew something must have gone wrong.
This is nothing, you should see them.
Han and Chewie's relationship is probably the best part of the movie. Their bickering with each other is definitely in line with what was seen in the original trilogy. And it's also nice that Chewie gets a lot more play here, given that I was a bit disappointed in his lack of screen time in The Last Jedi. But Lando is a bit of a different story. It's clear that Donald Glover is doing his damnedest to channel Billy Dee Williams, and sometimes it feels weird. There are moments, though, where he brings his own flair, and they're probably the best Lando moments in the movie. The action sequences are also a definite highlight, with the train scene early on being fast and energetic, and also it's a train heist, and those are just fun by default. But easily the most memorable sequence is the Kessel Run, which has a lot jam-packed into it. Now you might be thinking, the Kessel Run? Really? That was just another check on the Wikipedia list. And yeah, it shocks me too, the Kessel Run has no right being as fun as it is. But I'll be damned. It's pretty good.
A little something I picked up from my pal Needles. Best street racer in all Corellia. Till he crashed. And died doing this.
I
It also makes a pretty neat callback to Empire Strikes Back with Lando's droid L3, who's a lot of fun and stages a droid liberation on Kessel, which is different and new and it's refreshing. But she's put into the Falcon and becomes its navigation, which is a nice callback, tie-in, whatever you want to call it, to this.
I don't know where your ship learned to communicate, but it has the most peculiar dialect.
So it's nice to see this movie is adding some minor stuff to the universe, as well as this entire scene having a lot of much bigger moments that just make me laugh every time. And if you were wondering what happened to the Falcon to make it look like crap, well, all it takes is a Kessel run, apparently. It's really funny how the first time Han gets the ship, he just absolutely trashes the thing. After the Kessel run, you get an overhead shot of the ship, and I just remember thinking every time, yeah, there's the Falcon. On top of all of that, the scene also brings out a lot of classic musical moments from the other films, with the TIE fighter attack from A New Hope, the asteroid field theme from Empire Strikes Back, and if I'm not mistaken, some music from the Jakku chase in The Force Awakens. The music overall is pretty good this time around, with John Williams returning to create an exciting new theme for Han Solo, and John Powell taking over the rest of the new material. And there's a lot of good stuff in here. But the whole film builds to the third act, which is filled with double crosses, triple crosses. It took me a couple goes to really figure out what was going on, but then again, I am incredibly stupid, so yeah. But it also shows the death of Dryden Voss, who I didn't mention, but he's a lot of fun. He's really chaotic. One moment he'll be all, "I'll rip off your face," and the next he'll be like,
"We should do this again, it's been fun."
I don't know, it's just kind of dumb and I like it. Oh, and also Han shoots first.
I hope you're still paying attention, because now I'm going to tell you the most important...
So take that, special editions. The film ends with Han Solo playing a second game of Sabacc against Lando and winning the Millennium Falcon. Fair and square this time as well. But not before we see a hologram of Darth Maul. Man, the movie didn't really need this. The movie was doing its best by being largely separate from the rest of the universe and not really dealing with Sith and Jedi and all that stuff, but I guess here's Darth Maul. It might have been more exciting if he wasn't already a big part of Clone Wars and Rebels, or if he didn't already die in Rebels. But that's where Solo ends, with Han heading to Tatooine to, unbeknownst to him, put a bounty on his own head. Solo's fun, right? It's fun. I need to stop saying the word fun. It's not really anything special, but I'm not sure it was trying to be. It's just 2 hours of entertainment, and I think it's good for Star Wars to do that every once in a while. But it would be nice if the movie didn't look like mud. The coloring and the lighting are really off in this movie. It makes it pretty hard to see what's going on. Especially underground in Kessel, when there's a lot of Wookiees running around. Like, who's who? Is that Chewbacca, or is that someone else? No, nope, that's someone else. Oh, there's Chewbacca. Okay, I've got it figured out now. We're good. If the visuals of the movie reflected the tone better, it would have won some more points. But as it stands, Solo is pretty unremarkable, but it's still an entertaining movie. But no one went to see it, which sent a big signal to Disney that the anthology films weren't going to be majorly successful. With the planned Boba Fett movie canned, the rumored Kenobi movie turned into a streaming series, the box office failure of Solo sent waves through the franchise, and marked a major turning point to Disney's approach to the franchise. Disney decided in the wake of Solo they'd slow down on releasing movies, as it seemed that one every year so close together wasn't a worthwhile business strategy, and they needed to have larger breaks in between so that the movies would rekindle their event film status. But the future of the franchise was beginning to be laid out. Not only was Episode 9 set to release December 2019, but Disney also announced other plans for the future that weren't theatrical. With no other films coming in 2018, Comic-Con instead showed off some other aspects of Star Wars. A Clone Wars panel was held, where it was announced that the fan-beloved animated series would return for a 12-episode 7th and final season, to debut on the upcoming Disney streaming service called Disney+. This was undoubtedly exciting. The return of the cancelled series that never really got a true conclusion. It was all fans could have wanted, and the warm reception felt very similar to the excitement felt when Episode 7 was announced back in 2012. In October 2018, more details were revealed about Jon Favreau's live-action series. It was to be called The Mandalorian, with episodes directed by Dave Filoni, Taika Waititi, Bryce Dallas Howard, and more. With it being a live-action series separate from the films, the hope was that it would explore or the dark underbelly of the Star Wars universe, and not dive into the larger universe that much at all, only being a piece of the larger puzzle. The future of Star Wars on television was looking bright, but the future on the big screen was yet to be seen. But it wasn't going to be much longer before Episode 9, the conclusion to the Skywalker saga. Excitement was palpable in 2019, with the future of Star Wars looking incredibly bright. Not only would the first live-action series, The Mandalorian, debut in November, but the year would end with Episode 9, the ultimate conclusion to 40 years of Star Wars. While excitement was at an all-time high, so were expectations. Everyone knew that Episode 9 could not exist in a vacuum, and it would have to have some kind of response to the division around The Last Jedi. But would the film double down and continue the new ideas laid out by The Last Jedi? Or would it try to undo them and give in to the most toxic side of the Star Wars fanbase? Audiences had to wait and see. But April 2019 saw Star Wars Celebration, which not only showed more Clone Wars, some details about The Mandalorian, but also the first teaser to Episode 9. The teaser not only showed new footage and got people excited for what was to come, but it also had the same text that was seen in the first Phantom Menace trailer, bringing things full circle. The teaser was full of mysterious imagery, big action, big spectacle, and the ruins of the Death Star? Wait, how did that... Hold up, was that Emperor Palpatine? But he got thrown down a shaft and exploded, and then the Death Star exploded around him, and yet here it is, and he's alive somehow? Okay, do we at least have a title? The Rise of Skywalker. With the title revealed, Star Wars fans everywhere collectively said, "Huh, that's different." The title definitely sounded very different than any before, but it did have a sense of hope to it, and questions were raised about who or what it referred to. As the year continued, more marketing for The Rise of Skywalker confirmed that all would come full circle in the final installment. With it being the ultimate conclusion and all, expectations began to rise. The film had to not only conclude the sequel trilogy and all the character arcs within it, but find a satisfying end to the 42-year Star Wars saga as a whole, and try to appeal to the Star Wars fanbase and unify them under one movie yet again. No pressure. But while expectations and excitement were soaring for The Rise of Skywalker, the gaze turned towards the first season of The Mandalorian, which began streaming weekly episodes in November and December 2019. Not only did it show a different side to the universe and use new filmmaking technology to its advantage, it also introduced Baby Yoda, which, yeah, he's adorable, and if anyone tries to hurt him, I swear I will rip out their spine! What was I saying? Oh, yeah, right. Sorry. The Mandalorian seemed to unify Star Wars fans like no other piece of media had under the Disney umbrella, with it being a fresh look at the galaxy far, far away, with new-sounding music, new characters, new planets, new ships, as well as references, callbacks, and familiar things that kept the nostalgia alive. But while I think the series is pretty good, I think it's missing something at its core, a strong, beating heart, an emotional connection to anyone other than Baby Yoda. I feel like if the show nailed down that core emotion, it'd be a truly great Star Wars series. But I'm definitely an outlier here, as the show was a major success and the response on the internet was incredibly positive. So while Star Wars was finding success on the small screen, the big screen was getting ready for The Rise of Skywalker. The final marketing push came in full force with a 2-minute special look showing behind-the-scenes footage over the 40 years, as well as the insane cultural impact Star Wars has had and how important it is to not only pop culture, but culture as a whole. And it was time to see how it would all come together. The 9-film saga was finally here. December 20th, 2019 had arrived, and audiences were ready for the rise of Skywalker. But did it live up to enormous expectations? Did it provide a solid conclusion to the Skywalker saga? Well, no. While The Rise of Skywalker is a visually exciting action-adventure filled with big moments, great special effects, great eye candy, and some cool use of miniatures, the one thing people didn't predict was just how aggressive the movie was going to be. By that I mean, the film is incredibly reactionary to The Last Jedi, and often retracts what that movie set up, the worst one being the revelation that Rey isn't a nobody, which was an idea that puts magic back into the Force, but instead she's Palpatine's granddaughter. So this means she has Force lightning, a trait exclusive to Palpatine's, apparently. No other character had that, no siree. It just makes Star Wars based on genetics again, and it removes a lot of the magic of the Force. But on top of that, the movie is moving at a breakneck pace. It's moving so incredibly fast that you have to work to keep up. You can't take a second to breathe. There's no time to reflect on what's happening because the movie just keeps moving. If you stop watching for 30 seconds, you'll actually miss like 10 plot points. The movie even forgets its own plot points. Early on, Finn says that he has something to tell Rey.
Rey! Rey, I never told you, Rey!
It's brought up a couple times after that, but Finn never actually tells Rey. Sure, we, the audience, can figure out what he tried to say, but Rey never found out, so what was the point? At the very least, the breakneck pace means there's a lot that happens in the movie, and not all of it is bad, but for every good thing, there's a bad thing to follow. One of the most fun aspects is seeing Rey, Finn, and Poe together on screen, after they were separated in each of the previous two movies. It's a satisfying payoff, and their dynamic is a lot of fun. But Finn and Poe don't really have anything to do in this story. Poe was apparently a spice runner, and Finn is really good at killing his former friends, the Stormtroopers. Also, the two of them are each given a new love interest, which is kinda redundant considering we all know they each already have the perfect love interest. Yeah, you know what I'm talking about. Make Finn and Poe gay, you cowards. But what is a decent aspect of the movie is the reveal that General Hux is actually a spy that's been feeding information to the Resistance. This is a really fun idea and is totally in line with the character. I wonder where this will go.
Tell him we found our spy.
Oh, well, I guess he's dead now. Alright. But easily the most offensive part of the movie is what it does with Rose. Or rather, what it doesn't do with Rose because she's not really in the movie. And that's really disappointing. And I really feel bad for Kelly Marie Tran, dude. I mean, she was super excited to be part of this universe, got a fun role in The Last Jedi, but then was slammed with the most toxic side of Star Wars for 2 years. And to add insult to injury, she's effectively removed from the next film. I mean, guys, come on, man. That's not to say the movie is all bad, however. There are a lot of moments that are pretty well done. The humor overall works really well here, with most of the funny stuff coming from C-3PO.
Did we lose him? Looks like it!
Excellent job, sir! Terrible job, sir!
On top of that, the Leia scenes are largely seamless. I don't envy the task the filmmakers had of finding a satisfying conclusion to that character without Carrie Fisher, and I think their efforts were largely successful here. I mean, I notice what's going on because I know the real-world scenario, but if a kid were to watch this in 20-30 years, they might notice something was off, but they'd probably just roll with it, and I think that's an achievement. Rey is also pretty good in this. For the record, I like Rey in all three of these movies, and despite her being a Palpatine, I think it's a decent motivator that Palpatine had her parents killed. It's a powerful emotional drive that makes the character believable. But easily the best aspect of the movie is Kylo Ren. His character is the one thing that was largely consistent throughout all of the sequel films, and I think it comes to a really satisfying place in this movie. There's a scene where he talks to Han Solo, effectively redoing the scene on the bridge from The Force Awakens, except this time probably the way Kylo wanted it to go.
I know what I have to do, but I don't know if I have the strength to do it.
This is probably my favorite moment in the whole movie. It has this feeling of satisfaction. It's a really solid end to Kylo Ren, and an effective redemption of Ben Solo. Ian McDiarmid coming back as Palpatine is also a lot of fun. I mean, the idea of Palpatine coming back I'm not thrilled with, but Ian McDiarmid is giving a really good performance here. You can tell he's having so much fun playing a guy who just relishes in being the most evil bastard in the galaxy. But Palpatine needs to get his plan straight. Like, I mean, at the start he's like,
kill the girl.
But then he wants her alive so that she can kill him, and his spirit will pass into her, and she will be Empress Palpatine. But then upon discovering that Rey and Ben are a Force dyad, he sucks out their life force and heals himself to be the one true Emperor. I mean, as long as he knows that he's changing plans every 5 minutes. So we've discussed how the film isn't exactly a working conclusion to the sequel trilogy, but does it at least satisfy some needs for the 9-film saga? Well, it's kinda hard to satisfy all 9 films when you ignore 3 of them. Don't get me wrong, the prequels aren't good, they have a lot of issues, but the generation that grew up with them are nostalgic for them now, and reception has turned around now that the kids of the day have gotten a voice. So why not give them some love? There's a moment in this movie where an entire army of ships show up. Maybe it'd be neat if we saw some Naboo fighters, some Coruscant ships, some repurposed battle droids or something. Could you imagine if Jar Jar came back in this moment? It'd only need to be for one shot, but I think I'd lose my mind. As it stands, though, while this scene is visually impressive and gets a reaction out of you from that, it's empty because it's just a bunch of ships. You don't know who's in them. Aside from Wedge, which did put a smile on my face, so could you imagine if that happened 50 more times with a bunch more characters? It was this perfect opportunity to bring together all of the characters from across the saga into one final conclusion. And they biffed it. But the film comes to an end with Rey hearing the voices of the Jedi long past, and she uses 2 lightsabers and destroys Palpatine, which should probably still count for the whole spirit passing thing. But the army of Star Destroyers is destroyed, and Rey dies. But she's saved by Ben transferring some life force to her. They kiss? Oh, that's... okay. And then Ben dies. Leia fades away, and the victory is felt everywhere. Well, at least on planets in the original trilogy, because it wouldn't make sense to see Coruscant celebrating right now, would it? But the film ends with Rey, Finn, and Poe hugging it out. And this is effective. This feels like an emotional end to their characters for the trilogy. I mean, I still like each of their characters, and this being their last movie for the foreseeable future is something to get emotional about. So points for that movie. The final scene shows Rey burying Luke and Leia's lightsabers, declaring herself Rey Skywalker, and looking out towards a binary sunset as the credits roll. And that is the end of the Skywalker saga. Reactions to Rise of Skywalker were incredibly mixed. It seemed that a large majority of people saw the film as inferior to the previous 2 films in the sequel trilogy, even if they enjoyed it. After this, the films would take a much-needed hiatus, with it being a couple years before the next theatrical release. But there are still a lot of projects yet to come. Rian Johnson is still making his trilogy of films, a Kevin Feige-helmed movie is in development, as well as a couple more series for Disney+. But now, after 42 years, the 9-film saga is complete. And while it's mixed with both good and bad movies, it's still surreal to look at this now, and think about how far Star Wars has come since 1977. With new generations, new creators, new visions, all coming together for one simple goal of making Star Wars for audiences everywhere. But Star Wars was gonna change. Things are gonna be different after the conclusion to the saga. And while The Mandalorian gave audiences a taste of what the franchise could look like beyond Episode 9, the future was laid with a path into uncharted territory. It was time to go into the unknown. What was Star Wars going to do next? So here we are, at the end of the 47-year journey throughout the history of Star Wars. The year 2020 marked a turning point in the Star Wars universe, being the first year post-Skywalker saga. This year's been relatively light on new Star Wars, but it has had 2 big moments in the sun. The first started in February 2020 with the return of the Clone Wars, with the final season running weekly until the start of May. The season consisted of a trio of 4 episode arcs, the first of which centered on the Bad Batch, a splinter group of clones. Overall, this first arc was largely enjoyable, but nothing to write home about. The same can be said about the second arc involving the Martez sisters, which was criticized for, as some put it, being filler, and just buying time before the arc that people actually wanted to see. Eventually, the final 4 episodes did arrive, and they were exactly what people were waiting for. The final conclusion to the Clone Wars story. And these 4 episodes are easily some of the best Star Wars that has ever Star Wars'd. They're filled with the sense of dread because it takes place at the same time as Revenge of the Sith, so we all know what's about to happen. The tension all builds towards Order 66, and when the Order is called, everything changes. The moment the clones turn against Ahsoka is one of the most heart-pounding moments in the entire franchise.
Fight him! Fight!
The arc and the show itself ended on May 4th, Star Wars Day, with a final episode titled Victory and Death. It was a momentous occasion, not just because the fan-beloved series was coming to a much-belated end, but the Clone Wars is the last major Star Wars project that had direct involvement from George Lucas. After this, Lucas would be fully disconnected from the universe he created. That isn't to say he has no impact, it is, you know, the universe he created, and he still visits the sets. But this was the last time he had direct involvement in the creation of a piece of the universe. Tears streamed down fans' faces when the Clone Wars concluded with an emotional and tragic ending, with ideas that fans had been waiting for executed to perfection for a satisfying conclusion to the series. But the Clone Wars isn't the only piece of Star Wars media in 2020, as The Mandalorian Season 2 is currently in the midst of its run. Overall, Season 2 is an improvement over Season 1 thus far, with better action scenes, big moments, more Star Wars Easter eggs, and characters to be excited about, and each episode feels different, really highlighting the different strengths of each director. But I do think it's still missing that emotional core, that heart, and while Baby Yoda is still the best, I can't shake the feeling that the show will need something more. But who knows, maybe the rest of Season 2 has something up its sleeve. I guess we'll have to wait and see. Wow, we're all cut up now. I guess this leaves us with one more thing. It's time to rank the Star Wars movies, baby! Now, before I start, I'm just gonna say that you're most definitely going to disagree with this list. So let's get going. In making this video, I watched all live-action theatrical movies in release order, and now I'm gonna rank them from worst to best, in my own opinion, of course. So let's start with the worst one, The Phantom Menace. It's slow and boring despite having frantic pacing. I don't like it, and Qui-Gon sucks. Attack of the Clones. Not much better than Phantom Menace, but it at least moves smoother and the action's cool sometimes, so. Revenge of the Sith. It's at least more interesting than the other prequels, and it holds a special place to me because this was my go-to Star Wars movie when I was a kid, so. Rogue One. While it's visually amazing and the effects are cool, the flat characters really drag things down. The Rise of Skywalker. It's relentless in its pacing, and it doesn't make a lot of sense, but there are some good character moments here and there. Solo. Pretty standard affair, but it's a light breeze and something you can show anyone. Return of the Jedi. It's got lots of really great moments, and the first and third act are incredible, but Han Solo's got nothing to do, and that's a bummer. The Last Jedi. Lots of great ideas and great moments, held down by the not-so-great ideas. But if liking it makes the toxic Star Wars fans mad, then I'm game. The Force Awakens. This was my first new Star Wars movie, so it's special to me in that way. But I also just really like it. I really enjoy the new characters, and it breezes by really quickly, which is always nice. A New Hope. The one that started it all, with all the iconic moments still aped 43 years later. How the movie managed to inspire so many and start something so special is incredibly impressive. And it all started here. The Empire Strikes Back, a benchmark for sequels and franchise films for four decades. It's fun, exciting, and the characters are at their best here, with it defining what Star Wars would be forever. So there you go, there's my ranking. Post yours in the comments or whatever, just don't yell at each other if you disagree because that's toxic. But with all of this done, with the entire retrospective complete, I'm left with only one question. Why did I do this? Why did I decide to talk about Star Wars for 2 hours? Well, it's pretty simple actually. I love Star Wars. Star Wars is unlike anything else in pop culture. There is no other franchise that's had this kind of long-time success that's been able to not only entertain but also inspire. There's a magic to Star Wars, how it's carried through generations, just like the stories of the films itself. Fans have grown up with their own favorite movies, their own view of what Star Wars is and what it feels like. It's special that a franchise like this can have such a diverse pool of fans, where everyone's ranking of the films looks different. Everyone has a different favorite character, and everyone has their go-to favorite aspect of the franchise. Some love the movies, some love the shows, some love the video games, and they're all valid. You might think The Rise of Skywalker is the worst movie ever out there, But somewhere out there, someone else says it's their favorite Star Wars movie, and that's genuinely amazing. The insane cultural impact of Star Wars is something truly special. Nothing else has or ever will have the impact of Star Wars. It's such a defining franchise. Marvel's the big name in film right now. Avengers Endgame is the most successful movie of all time, and I don't want to discredit their success because I like those movies too, but they're not Star Wars. Star Wars is unique in its ability to bring everyone together, despite how angry some people get about it. And yeah, it sucks when one of the movies isn't what you wanted, but there will always be the ones you like, and there will always be more after that. I try not to get too worked up about it. I mean, I'll criticize the ones I don't like, but at the end of the day, I still love Star Wars, and nothing is gonna change that. The future of the franchise will continue to excite me and so many others, no matter if it's a movie, an animated series, a live-action series, a video game, it doesn't matter. It's all Star Wars, and it's all a part of this magical universe. Over the course of 43 years, Star Wars has ingrained itself into the minds of just about everyone. Like, you can't honestly tell me that you haven't tried to use the Force to get the TV remote that's too far away. I mean, we've all done that. If for nothing else, through thick and thin, Star Wars will always be a beacon of light, a beacon of entertainment, something simple. A colossal story of good against evil, with heroes and villains that have spanned generations. Star Wars has never stopped being what it has always been, what it was intended to be back in 1977. It's something to escape to, a fantasy, an adventure, a dream. It's a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. May the Force be with you. Always.